Excellent, lovely. Thanks very much, James. And our last talk is from Connor Kenny, who's from MSF.
Cheers, thanks very much. So, thanks very much for having me here. My name's, sorry, I'm just going back. So my name is Dr. Conor Kenny, and I'm a medical doctor with Medecins Sans Frontieres, and I've been working with them for the last 2 years in the European migrant crisis. And the purpose of my talk today is to again elaborate about the push and pull factors, about what pushes people away from their countries and what makes them go on these incredible journeys, using Europe as an example. But obviously this can be transferred to many other contexts, such as Central America and Southeast Asia. And also, at the end, just to so people understand about how government policies contribute to morbidity and mortality, and perhaps suggest a few personal opinions on how we can address these challenges. So this is my work for the last 3.5 months, working in the Central Mediterranean, where we rescued 4,500 people in the 3.5 months that I was there. But in the same time, 1,200 people died. And this is my time spent in Lesbos Island, working with unaccompanied minors. And here in Idomeni, which was a transit camp in northern Greece, and then was a destination point. It turned into a destination point for Syrian refugees. And this is my when I was working here in March of last year. Destination point because it was closed due to the EU-Turkey deal. So Tamar, are you able to press play on that video? So this is just So this is a video from the Italian Coast Guard, which just gives an idea of the type of experiences that we've been having undertaking search and rescue in the Central Mediterranean, one of many thousands that have taken place over the last number of years. So as you can see, it's quite a chaos out there. And to understand why people enjoy this is to understand what pushes them away. And the meeting so far today has so many people have eloquently explained about what drives people, especially in Rear Admiral Marsetti's talk. He's talked about the five factors that contribute to migration: conflict, poverty, social factors, demographic factors, and the environment as well. And this is why a meeting like today is so important, to understand about what pushes people away. There's also the pull factors as well. Say Coca-Cola, for example, or globalization. People through the internet see the attraction of moving to a more prosperous country, and you know, who would blame them? I'm going to speak about particularly the Central Mediterranean route. So basically, the Central Mediterranean route goes from Libya towards Italy. And this is a route which has people who migrate from West Africa, Central Sub-Saharan Africa, and East Africa. Traditionally, Libya was the transit point, or the destination. Libya, an oil-rich economy until the fall of Gaddafi in 2011, then became a lawless society, on which it hasn't really recovered since. And since then, thousands of people have migrated from Libya on these rubber boats. The journey to Libya is a deadly one as well, and it's not well documented. 14 people die every single day going through the Sub-Saharan Africa to reach Libya. Then when they get to Libya, they are subjected to rape, torture, slavery, and subjected to infectious disease in inhumane camps, which have been well documented by the International Organization of Migration and the UN. However, we continue as Europeans to fund these camps, to keep them going, and to drive this industry. Next is the fact that when people are in Libya, for many of them that they cannot escape this lawless country, and many of them are driven onto these boats simply because they cannot apply for asylum. Many of them who are entitled to asylum do not have the opportunity, and instead we force them to get onto these boats to seek safety. As a result, a smuggling industry develops, and as a result, maybe other migrants will go along and fuel that industry as well. And then we have a problem like we see here. The death toll in the Mediterranean is up to May of this year, was 14 people also dying every day. So 2,400 people so far this year. There was a big lot of criticism about NGOs working in the Mediterranean. Are you a pull factor? Are you the reason why people are coming across? Which was a very disturbing narrative in 2017. The fact that that was brought up as a topic in mainstream media, considering the fact that NGOs only became involved in 2014, after this route had been very much established, and they came and they were involved in response to numerous tragedies that happened in the central Mediterranean. But in no way am I saying NGOs are the solution. Clearly the governments, European governments, are responsible for doing search and rescue in this area. If you want to just press play for a second, Tamar. So that was a video just to show that instead European governments aren't taking responsibility and they've outsourced to the Libyan Coast Guard. Libya, as I said, is a failed state of many governments and many different coast guards who we fund to take care of our refugee problem. There you've seen a rescue which took place back in May, where the coast guard started opening fire on a group of migrants who are defenseless in the water. And this is a video, which is a bit long, which I'm not going to play, of behavior of one of the Libyan Coast Guards whipping everyone on that boat. So this is the type of industry that we are fueling. This is the type of industry that Boris Johnson in August said he basically endorsed it as a way of keeping migrants and terrorists out of Europe. So the problem I feel is that our policies are, by defunding these de facto militias, are not to protect the refugees. Europe wants to be protectors. We want to protect ourselves from the refugee. And that is obviously a serious problem. So just moving on to something different from a more or less like health outlook, is when we do the rescue, the people that we see in the medical clinic are as a result of the detention of which they have been subjected to for many months. So either torture or rape, as I mentioned, sepsis as a result of the conditions there, maybe gunshot wounds. And then also we see the consequences of the journeys that these people have gone on. Over there you see addressing a fuel burn. So fuel burns are really common. The fuel would spill in the rubber boats and literally burn the people alive from the waist down. They couldn't move in these packed boats and suffering serious burns. Also, you might have dehydration, exhaustion, victims of drowning as well. So it was obviously a very busy time for us. When people get to Europe, they're now, as a result of the Dublin Agreement, forced to stay in the country in which they arrive in, putting a significant burden on the health service of that country, whether it's Italy, and at the moment it's Italy, and Greece obviously undergoing a serious burden. They're also detained in hotspots as well for processing where their applications are processed. These sort of camps that people have to endure have a lot of medical problems associated with them as well, whether it's upper respiratory tract infections, gastrointestinal disturbance such as diarrhea, and also serious mental health need as well among this population, especially after the experiences of which they have come from to get to Europe. One particular passion of mine is, an interest is definitely mental health, and having spent a number of months working with unaccompanied minors, my question is, the 10,000 unaccompanied minors who went missing last year in 2016, what has actually happened there? So this is quite a busy slide. I'm not going to go through everything. But in terms of the type of solutions that we can find for this migrant crisis, it's clearly, it's complex, as Rear Admiral Marsetti alluded to, but it's not, he described grey areas. A lot of it is grey, but a lot of it's black and white as well. And actually making safer channels for these people, you know, who are entitled to asylum, to actually apply for asylum as per human rights law. And also, we need more research to understand what are the causes of why people are actually leaving and what can be done to address it. And a lot of brilliant comments have been made today about potential solutions for that. Also, clearly within Europe, it's as if we're surprised every time some sort of migrant crisis happens, like we've never had this before. We don't know how to react, and clearly it's time at some stage that we have an integrated strategy that we can actually deal with this migrant crisis and actually be proactive to it rather than reactive. And that's it, so thanks very much for your time.